And I just go there.
Oh, is my name? Central Board Facilitators Toastmasters Club, 9958 to order. Thank you to everyone for being here this evening. We've got quite the crowd. I'd like to say May brought all of her posse. I'm very excited. So if you're reading this evening, which some of you are, and you have not yet signed our visitor log and guest book, Gail has a clipboard that you'll see in the second table, so we'll make sure to pass that around and just let you learn more about Toastmasters. If you have a phone or other electronic device that make noise, please put them on silent mode now. The restrooms are very close by. Just go out any one of these four doors, swing left, then another left, and they're on the right. At Toastmasters, we provide a supportive and positive learning experience in which members are empowered to develop communication and leadership skills, resulting in greater self-confidence and personal growth. Through this mission, each Toastmaster gains a clear understanding of the club's purpose, and the organization as a whole benefits from a shared set of values and goals. Please help me welcome our thought and pledge leader this evening, Mr. Charlie Bondelier.
When you finally realize that the very essence of who you are is a measure of borrowed time. We borrowed the time from the universe. We borrowed our existence in this place. Everything beautiful and everything bad was given to us so that we could make a choice. Now what we do with that choice? What do we do with the reckless hate in the world? We teach. By Albert Einstein. Please stand up for the pledge of allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
No, there she is. Please help me welcome our president, Jane Major.
Good evening, fellow Toastmasters, and look at all these wonderful guests that we have. I can only imagine who they're here to see. Certainly not me. So it is my pleasure to welcome all of you here tonight, and especially to welcome our Toastmaster that you guys are all here to support tonight. What I would like to do, since we have a very jammed schedule tonight, instead of going through the usual introductions, I would like for each one of you to stand and maybe give me your name and what club you're from, and let's make that really quick so we just have a clue who you are.
Our guest,
please. Yes, our guest, please.
That's you too, Jeremy.
You know, I wasn't sure if she was
Yeah. Stand and we'll just click around the room.
All just stand up at the same time. Anyway.
Yeah. Okay.
My name is Bessie. My son is on Voices of Opportunity for the City of Toastmasters. I'm the area 44 area director, and I came here to give
Tony
about to speak tonight. I'm excited about it, and I'm sure it will give me some encouragement to keep going, so that's why I'm here.
Yeah. I'm Bill Boyd. I'm with Omni Toastmasters Club. I'm here for May.
I'm Janine Oates, and I'm going to join this club right here, Central Quarter Facilitator, since I live in Altamont.
Yes.
I'm Jeremy Udell. I am here representing ACE tonight, ACE Advanced Toastmasters Club. I have an announcement I'd like to make at the end, but I know you are jam-packed for time, so I won't make it right now. I am also here to support May and Tony because I love them both very much. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Ted Altman.
But I'm coming back for Tony in May. Congratulations, all of you.
And I'm Michelle Dellock. I'm the president of the Altamont Articulators, and I'm also here to support my fourth speech. Woo!
And we do have another guest all the way in the back. Could you give us your name?
Just enough to say a name.
I'm a visitor here. My name is Jim Smith. I'm from this area. I'm a customer here, a client here.
A resident.
And they said, I stumbled on this couple of you in the elevator, and I said, hey, I know them. They meet there occasionally.
Welcome. And I think we have one other person who has been a member but is a guest now.
Yes. I'm Wendy Wood, friend of Tony and May, and also Dawn is here.
Hey, Dawn.
Hi, I'm Dawn Snyder. I'm here to support May.
Okay. I think we got thank you guys very much. And in the interest of time, I would like to move on. Before you can get engaged in anything, you must be engaged in your lives. What are your dreams? What are you doing about them? Please welcome Jonathan Dunn.
Thank you, Madam President. Always nice to be able to say Madam President here, too. So
hey,
otherwise. Welcome, everybody. It is a phenomenal crowd out here tonight, and as we've mentioned over and over again, we have an incredibly busy agenda. So the good news of that statement is it means I will talk very little. But the first thing I'm going to talk about tonight are our agenda changes. Unfortunately, we don't have too many. But the first one to look at is we have Jeremy Udell standing in for a grammarian, and we will meet him again in just a moment. And then on the speaker three, it says to be announced. That is actually going to be an 8 to 10 minute speech, and the title is going to be listing presentation given to us by Richard. Otherwise, everything else.
What was
that again? 8 to 10. Is as it is. So I picked the subject tonight, what are your dreams? And for many of you that come to our club, you know that I own a wellness facility. And people come to me sometimes in pretty sad shape. And I could easily look at them and say, oh, they're lazy, oh, they're sad, whatever it is. But what I see when I see someone come in is a person that has disengaged from a very important aspect of their life, their physical health. So the first thing that I have to do when I meet with them is figure out a way to get them re-engaged in their life, to get them excited about their life, to get them wanting to actually live their life again. So this sheet, and everyone should have one of these sheets at their table. It says 20 dream starter questions, and on the far right there's a block that says the Dream Manager Program. When we were young, we all had dreams. I think by a show of hands, which we won't do, that most of us aren't doing what we initially dreamed about as a young person. And we've kind of quit group dreaming. We think we don't deserve to dream. We think it's silly to dream. We think it's a waste of time to dream. But the first thing I do when I sit down with a person anymore is we get them out of the current physical state that they're in. And the way that we get them out of the current physical state that they're in is by having them do a dream storm. These 20 questions on this sheet are incredibly powerful. We're not going to have time to go through the whole thing the way I intended tonight, but I would fully encourage you to take this sheet home, take it incredibly seriously, and get to 100 dreams on that dream list. That will get you out of the current state of affairs that you're in. If you're bad, it'll bring you up to good. If you're already good, it will bring you to great. It's for all levels. What I'm going to do right now is I want to just take a couple minutes, and if everyone could look at question number two here and go ahead and answer it. It's, if you could take a road trip with anyone and go anywhere, where would you go and who would you go with? And even as I look around the room, something I've gotten good at, I saw probably 40 to 50% of the room immediately smile. And knowing that you probably woke up early today, had an alarm clock that was a rude awakening, knowing that you probably worked all day, and then knowing that you came here afterwards, to see you smile, you can see the power within answering that question. And then I'm going to leave it at this. If two or three people wouldn't mind raising their hand and sharing their answer, I would like to hear why. And I know, Michelle, I had you think the second one, but I would love to know, who would you like to go on a road trip with? Yeah, go ahead and stand up.
I am going on a road trip within a few years with Paul. We are packing up motorcycles along with our camper, and we're taking the bikes from Florida to Alaska. The trip should take 3 months.
Oh,
oh my goodness. Good job.
Go ahead, Bill. I would love to hear it. And then we'll have time for one more after that.
2018, I would love to take a Mediterranean cruise around Italy, pausing for 3 days first, starting from Rome and taking a short bus trip on Viking cruise lines, and I would like to take it with my wife. It's booked.
Do you mind if I go? That sounds darn good. Anybody else? Okay, Jay, our president, thank you.
I would like to take a road trip with my daughter and my son-in-law, and hopefully by then some grandchildren, starting in Key West, going from there all around the country to every national park in this country. I love my daughter more than life itself, and this country is fabulous and amazing and beautiful, and I have had so many wonderful trips with my family growing up, visiting those same parks. It's time for us to do the same.
Thank you, Jason. Yeah. Yes, honey. All right, see.
Different. I would like to take a road trip with Michelle Obama, starting from Lake Mary, traveling on I-10 to California, going up Highway 1 all the way up to Canada, and then we'll figure it out from there.
Maybe we'll have time for some more later, but whenever I sit with a company or a group of people, this is exactly what happens, where people start going, oh, that sounds good, oh, that sounds good, oh, that sounds good. Now, the last part of that is, we live in incredibly trying times right now with a lot of tension, and probably the most important job that you will ever have in your entire life is being a friend to somebody. And if you have people that you call your friends, and you don't know what their dreams are, and they don't know what your dreams are, I'm here to tell you it's a subpar friendship. Because now I know I can support Michelle on that Alaska trip. I can drop her lines every once in a while to know that somebody's thinking about her. I can know about his cruise that he wants to take to the Mediterranean. Tony with her trip with Michelle Obama and Jay to our national parks. So if you want to take your friendship from good to great, like you want to take your speaking skills from good to great, do this list and do it with every single person that you proclaim that you care about. It will absolutely ignite your friendship into levels that you truly didn't know were possible. And now we have to learn the people that make this meeting possible. Our functionaries, the people that are working diligently behind the scenes, the first of which is our plenarian, a gentleman who's visiting from another club and a very close friend. Jeremy, please stand up and share with us what your responsibilities will be tonight.
Thank you, Jonathan. My job, first and foremost, is to bring the word of the day. The word of the day today will be fantasy. Fantasy. Does everyone know what it means? If you get a chance to speak today going forward, whether that be in a prepared speech, an evaluation, or a table topic, or even just standing announcing your role as a technical table participant, do your best to work in the word of the day, which is fantasy. The other thing I'll be doing is listening for good and bad uses of the English
English language, including very colorful phrases such as dream storm. Very interesting phrase right there. Or bad grammar. I don't always hear the bad grammar, so hopefully you all get a free pass tonight. But if you do and I hear it, I'll write it down. Thank you.
Thank you, Jeremy. Before I introduce our next functionary, and I just can't resist this, question number 10 is, what's your fantasy job? Actually, it says dream job, and fantasy will be a stand-in. And I want to just go ahead and say that it's okay if you pick a job that you do that you wake up and you're super excited to go to it every day. Like, you don't want to have a weekend because you love what you're doing Monday through Friday. That's okay. Let's meet our timer now, Miss Emma Hancock.
Strung together with bridge words such as and so, and will sound the buzzer unless there is someone in the room that does not care for it, such as May. All right, Emma, everybody else? The fine for each infraction is 10 cents. Guests and members who have not yet done their icebreaker will not be buzzed or fined, but I will keep track of those infractions. Note that this buzzer is not meant to embarrass, but to give immediate feedback in an area that needs to be improved.
Thank you, Gail. And our final functionary, our supervisor of elections, Ms. Susan Morgan, please.
Evaluator and most improved speaker. I will tally the results for award presentations at the end of the meeting. I'll also pick up any comments you might have written for the speakers or any meeting participant and deliver it to the appropriate person. Ms. Krzyzewska.
Thank you, Susan. All right, let's jump into the prepared speeches. I'm super excited for them all. Especially our first, what a special opportunity. Our 99-year-old member, May Gittles, will be giving her fourth speech, titled, Looking Backward, Looking Forward. May is a very special member of the club who's looking forward to celebrating her 100th birthday later this year, in the month of May. The speech is in celebration of her daughter Toni Gittle's birthday. Toni is a very active member of Toastmasters and a dynamic speaker. May's previous three speeches received a standing ovation. Her icebreaker, titled "I Could Have Danced All Night," was about meeting her Prince Charming. Speech number two was a letter to my husband, and speech number three was 97 isn't like 87. Because of issues related to aging, the format for this project will be an interview conducted by her loving daughter, Toni Gittles. Please welcome Toastmaster May Gittles.
We're going to be looking backward as well as looking forward this evening with my mother, May Gittles. Let's start by looking backward. As a beautiful young woman, you had three dreams. What were they?
Getting married, having children. What else, Tony?
A nice house.
And have a nice house. I was lucky to have all three.
Oh, so they weren't a fantasy?
No.
Your dreams came true. So tell us a little bit about how your life turned out. Where did you meet your Prince Charming?
In the workplace.
At work. That's typical. And was it love at first sight?
Well, we got used to each other.
But there was something about him that was attractive.
Yes, he looked like Paul Newman. He has blue eyes.
Blue eyes. Sounds wonderful. But were there problems at the time?
Well, he was married.
But apparently he got divorced and married you.
Yes, I was lucky.
I think he was lucky too. Well, what about the second part of your dream, having children? Did that work out?
Of course. You don't have a marriage without children.
No. But you only had one.
Yes.
But she turned out pretty good?
Yes.
Did you like being a mother?
Yes, I did.
Yeah.
We took my little monster out to parks. We tried them with her.
Her little curly-haired monster, right? Oh, yes. There's a picture on their handout of that cute little girl. So what does your daughter do now?
Take care of you.
What does your daughter do now?
Tell me.
She takes care of you.
Oh, I must tell you, she takes care of me.
So many people take care of you. Well, let's jump into the present. You're 99. Are you really 99?
Oh.
Absolutely.
Of course.
Oh, of course. Well, what do you like about being 99?
Well, I don't cook anymore.
You don't have to cook, okay.
And I don't drive, which I love to do, but
I'm
99.
Yeah, you have a chauffeur driving Miss Maisie, right?
Yeah, my daughter.
Yes. Well, you look pretty good for your age. And I hear you spend a lot of time with a bunch of men over at the assisted living facility.
Oh, absolutely. We play poker.
You play poker?
And I win.
Yes.
And I lose once in a while.
Do you like to play poker?
I love it.
No, that's not the right answer. You love it when you win.
Yes, of course.
Yes, you've always taken care of managing your money. Well, maybe not everything is so good about being 99.
You're right.
Yeah. You want to tell us what isn't so good?
Well, I can't see. I can't hear. What else can't I do?
Walk. You can't walk?
Oh, yes, I can't walk.
And what do you do all day long?
I pee.
Well, I don't know. You must have some superpower to have lived this long. Do you?
Of course not. They tell me I do.
Yeah.
Because I look so good.
I know. You have a sister that's 95.
Yes.
Yeah. Old age. You going to be around to take care of me?
Oh, I hope so.
Because I'm nearing old age. Well, I'm wondering if you have some words of wisdom for the audience here. Is there something you've learned in this lifetime?
Well, you know, it's pretty bad getting old. You need money so people can take care of you.
What so else? Old age is pretty expensive, huh?
Of course.
If you do it right, right? What about teeth?
Oh. Go to the dentist regularly because it's hell to work, bitch.
Well, what about your family? Maybe your children?
My children. My daughter.
Yeah. Well, what's your advice to them about their children?
Their children.
Yeah.
Be good to them.
Be good to them?
Yeah. How come? They may have to take care of you.
Well, you could always just make them feel guilty, right? Well, only if you're a Jewish mom.
Well, I am. She never dresses warm. And there's a lot of other things that I would do differently. I go out dancing every night, but I can't.
But you can stand up and sway back and forth, right?
Well,
we do quite dancing.
No.
You know what? I've heard people tell you you were a class act. Why do you think they say that?
Because I look good.
Yes, you do, Mama dear. You look awesome. And I thank you for this birthday present. Of speaking before my friends and sharing your life. So that wasn't so bad, was it?
No.
No? Mr. Toastmaster. How's your hearing? Did you hear the applause? Yes. All right.
Emma May, we have 1 minute on the clock. There's a little slip in front of everybody with a comment section for our first speaker. I'm sure May and Tony would love to hear from each and every one of you. So in this next minute, please write out a note for May and Tony. Thank you. Our next speaker describes herself as a city girl with an island heart. She just joined Toastmasters in October of 2016 and is already our VPPR. The first office she has held at the first club that she attends regularly. She is excited to be a part of Toastmaster and knows that Toastmasters will play a valuable role in her continued journey in life. Delivering her icebreaker speech, sparking the movement, please welcome Renee Taylor.
My mother moved to New York when I was 5 years old with my brother and I after divorcing my father. She said the island wasn't big enough for the both of them. When I was 8, we moved to Brooklyn from the Bronx, and Brooklyn was everything. I love living in Brooklyn. I grew up in a predominantly Caribbean community, so it's so close to my heart. And actually, I lived in my apartment for 20 years. The same apartment. There's nothing I would change about my time in Brooklyn except for the passing of my mother when I was 23. A few years later, I left New York. I was inspired to leave New York City. And there's a Chinese philosophy that states, the journey of 1,000 miles begins with one single step. And that was my first step to my journey. I had a friend that was from California. She came to New York to have that New York City experience. She was about to move back. And she said to me, Taylor, you can't live in New York City all your life. And that sparked the movement. A year and a half after that, I moved to San Francisco. I lived in San Francisco for 2 years, and I arrived just when, during the dot-com boom. I got laid off when the dot-com bubble had bust. But right before I got laid off, I had started to my own company. The company was called Hot Pink and Black. I did adult pleasure parties. Kind of like Tupperware parties, but with more durable plastic. I gained 2 appreciations in San Francisco. One was the love of wine, and the second was being an entrepreneur. From San Francisco, so being laid off, have my business in mind. My brother said, well, come down here to Hinesville, Georgia, where I'm at. And you could do parties to military wives. So I moved to Hinesville. Didn't quite work out the way I hoped. Hinesville sounds like its name, a very small town. So I spent an entire year doing something that most people would think is a fantasy, traveling between Hinesville and the Bahamas, 1-2 months. Also doing my business, my parties there. My brother finally sat me down and said, Renee, you need to settle down. So he sold me on the idea of moving to Atlanta, Georgia. It's supposed to be the Mecca for black people, for young aspiring women like me, entrepreneur, to get out there and continue on with that business. Had high aspirations for Atlanta, but it did not work out that way. In Atlanta, I could not find a steady job, but I was very fortunate that I had a temp agency that kept me busy. I also had a car that would break down every single time I had discretionary funds. It just knew. The one positive that came out of living in Atlanta during that time was that I had met some women that I forced a great relationship with, and I called these women my sister girlfriends. One of them actually got me involved in Toastmasters, and she spent hours on the phone last night helping me prepare my speech. From Atlanta, I decided I was going to move back home to the Bahamas. I lived here for a year, and I had some quite interesting jobs there. One was I was an assistant manager at a nightclub, and I also got a chance to work with the LA casting crew for the Pirates of the Caribbean. They came down to cast extras for that. I loved island life, and somehow I found my way back to New York. And I went for a visit and I decided to stay. Got a job the first day I went looking as a legal secretary. Lucky me. New York kind of lost its appeal to me after being gone for a while and traveling, that I had then decided that I didn't want to be in New York. I had two bad winters. I was here for 2 years. The first winter, transit strike. The second winter, a blizzard. I didn't know where I was going to go. One thing I did know was I wasn't going to go anywhere that was cold. So my brother then said, give Jacksonville, Florida a chance. I did my research. I said, okay, because I had nowhere else to go. So I went to Jacksonville, and it worked out pretty well. In Jacksonville, I got a job as an account manager at an insurance consulting firm. Steady job, good pay, beautiful apartment that I absolutely loved. And everything was going great. I was there for 4 years, but then I decided that I want something else. Somehow it came to me that I should go into counseling. So in March of 2012, I made up my mind I was going to go back to school. August of the same year, I was enrolled at UCF in a Master's of Social Work program. I got my certificate in marriage and family therapy July of that same year, and I'm very fortunate to be working now in my field. I work at an alternative school for girls as a counselor. I'm working on my license to become a licensed in clinical social work. And so far things are great, I'm loving it. I definitely know I made the right decision. Through that journey, it had taught me that one, my brother always has my back, and two, that each step that I have made, the places I have been, the people I've met along the way, they all serve the purpose in my life. And that purpose has led me here today, delivering my icebreaker speech and sharing my story with you. Thank you.
Madam Tyler, may we get 1 minute on the clock, please? At this time, please fill out your comments for Renee and her wonderful, wonderful, wonderful icebreaker speech. Our next presenter this evening is a truly amazing realtor by day and a very mediocre speaker by night. It's his words, not mine. I'm not inventing this intro as some sort of sick fantasy. In the real world, reviewing the listing process with a potential home seller would take much longer than 7 to 9 minutes. But here to practice a condensed and expedited version of his company's listing process from the Competent Communicator Manual, Project 8, Get Comfortable with Visual Aids, is Mr. Richard Sapp.
Everyone knows that selling your home is an important event. But what you may not know is that there are really only four aspects of real estate that make a difference when it comes time to sell your house. Mr. Toastmaster, fellow Toastmasters, and lots of guests, it's important that we cover this here before we get started to show you what a realtor, to reiterate what a realtor can and cannot control, and how I'm going to do my best with what I can control. So the four aspects of real estate that affect the sale of a home are location, condition, price, and margin. So we've all heard location, location, location. It is, in fact, the prime derivative in any home valuation. I cannot move your house from point A to point B. And unless you live in a fantasy, if you're wanting a lakefront sale price, but you live a block from I-4, we're going to have a problem. Condition. Some home sellers are willing to make major overhauls to their house before they put it on the market. And sometimes it's a good idea. New kitchens, new baths, new floors can really make a big difference. However, most of the time, sellers are really going to only want to do some light tidying up, fresh painting, light landscaping. So unless you're willing to make major renovations to your home, the condition that it is in is how we're going to have to sell it. You have an old house that's falling apart, unless you want to renovate it, I have to sell an old house that's falling apart. You're going to get that feedback when buyers come to your door. Price. Every house has a price that a buyer is willing to pay for. My responsibility is to help determine the maximum value that a buyer would pay for your specific home. And it's important to do that the first time that it goes on the market. And last but not least, marketing. This can actually be the difference in what sets your home apart from others. How can we reach as many potential buyers as possible? Sticking a sign in your yard and just posting it to Zillow most likely isn't going to be the trick. So, Mr. Seller, let me cover a little bit about our brokerage, myself and the team, and our processes before we go to list your house.
No.
Not yet. So the Core Group Real Estate was founded by Justin and Cheryl Core, a mother and son team that spent 10 years at Coldwell Banker before deciding that they needed and wanted more autonomy to service their buyers and sellers that a big retail company like Coldwell Banker just wasn't going to be able to provide. I switched my license over in February of 2016. I got my bachelor's degree in finance and marketing, my master's in business. I'm a multi-million dollar top producer, a graduate of the Realtor Institute. I'm on the professional committee, professional development committee for Orlando Regional Realtor Association. I'm also Gold Key certified for excellence and professionalism. We also have our listing care coordinator, Emily, and her responsibility is to collect all of the data that's going to go into the MLS. Keep in touch with all the title agents, loan officers, the other agents, myself, the sellers, the buyers, to make sure that this transaction moves forward smoothly. Michelle Holmbeck does the exact same thing, only on the buyer side. Whenever you're ready to purchase a home, she's going to make sure that we stay in compliance, that key dates are hit, and that we are keeping open communication. So we have a very friendly, open, team-oriented environment here. We also have our professional photographer, Whitney. She is professionally trained in real estate photography, as well as our social media expert, Ashley. You need social media these days. So, first thing that we're going to do is get the signed listing agreement from you. After you've hired me to work, it's our job now to start collecting as much data about your house as possible. The things that a buyer is really going to want to know. How old's the roof? How old's the AC? Are you in a flood zone? What school zones are this? What's your typical electric bill? We try to get all of that on the front end to save you headaches and mistakes, transactions down the road later. After that, we're going to walk your house and really help you determine what's going to make it as presentable as possible with the maximum amount of money that you're willing to invest. Once we give you that, photography is scheduled, ordered, and Emily starts putting everything into the MLS, which is our multiple listing service. That's where agents and realtors buy and sell real estate. We put it in with the goal of going live on Tuesday, Wednesday, or Thursday. Once it goes live, we have one shot to make a first impression. It goes to over 900 different real estate websites across the country, including Zillow, Trulia, Realtor.com. If you ever wondered how these work, what they do is they pull information from the MLS and then it is then on their website. So any mistake that we have is going to show up on over 900 different searches. I'll give you an example. What if you accidentally put in that your house has a one-car garage instead of a two-car garage? Think that's going to discount you from a certain number of searches? It is. Go ahead. So it's important that we pay attention to the right details at the right time prior to going on. The wrong house picture, the wrong detail, the wrong eating thing can make a very large difference in whether your house can be sold. Once it's live and on the market, our job is to then analyze how your home is performing in comparison to other houses that are like it. So this one particularly was performing better than 96% of the market. It can actually tell us, it's a little creepy, who's visiting the site, from which site, and how many people are coming per day and per week. So this is usable information that allows us to switch our marketing strategy accordingly. Then we have something called reverse prospecting. This is where, when an agent sends out your house to a different buyer, we can, again, a little bit weird, we can see what that buyer does with the house. Did they discard it? Did they choose it as a possibility? Or did they like it as a favor? We can then follow up with the agent, say, hey, what's the feedback? How come they don't want to see it? When do they want to see it? What can we do to make this deal go through? So all of this is actually available to most realtors, but they're not using it. And people do not understand that these tools exist and how to best market and promote your house. I mentioned earlier that the ideal time to go live is on Tuesday, Wednesday, or Thursday. More specifically, actually between the hours also of 1 and 3. And that's because there has been study after study that shows that that is the hot time that people are sitting at their computer opening emails. 1 to 3, you just got back from lunch and you don't want to work. You're opening your email. And that's also one thing that we do through the marketing is outside of just getting an email, there's video walkthroughs that we do, brokers opens, open houses, email campaigns, social media promotions, cold calling and door knocking. My job is to not sit in the office, do what we call a post and coast, but is to actually actively market your house to get it to sell. Once it's actually on the market, we subscribe to a system called Showing Time. And this actually allows the seller of the house to approve, deny, reschedule appointments right from their phone. They can block certain times out if they know that the kids go down for a nap at 2 o'clock, or they can block out 1 to 3. If they want 2 hours notice, 4 hours notice, 24 hours notice, they have control of when people are going to be showing the home. In addition to that, it shows who's going in the house and when they're going in the house. So it is a very safe feature that a lot of homeowners find very convenient to use. Once we get your house under contract, this is when the fun begins. So all the elements of negotiation include, well, not all, the contract and purchase price, the inspection results, the appraisal results, the closing date, the financing terms, anything that's actually open for negotiation is actually also open to cause a contract to fall through. Luckily, with my business background, I've been fortunate. I'm an expert at putting out fires. I've never lost a sale due to a buyer and seller dispute. So, Mr. Seller, appreciate you taking the time to listen to me today, and I look forward to working with you soon.
Madam Timer, may we have 1 minute on the clock, please? Madam Timer, may we have a timer's report, please?
Everybody was within time. 7 minutes and 20 seconds. Renee, you did 5 minutes and 57 seconds. Yay! And Richard, you did 9 minutes and 5 seconds.
Great job, everybody.
Thank you, Emma. Please cast your vote for best speaker, and Ms. Morgan will come around, collect your comments, and collect your votes. And before we move in to the table topic section this evening, how will I use this list once people have come up with 100 dreams? We picked 3 dreams for them to accomplish in year 0 to 1. We pick 1 dream for them to work on between 1 and 4 years. And then finally, we pick 1 dream to begin working on that is a 5+ year dream for their life. And either I'm their accountability partner, or we find a family member or friend who is. For over 25 years, Stephen has been hypnotizing anyone and everyone, willing and interested. Trained by experts in the field, Stephen can be found conducting group sessions, performing on stage, and helping individuals one-on-one. As a certified instructor with the National Guild of Hypnotists, with the National Federation of Neuro-Linguistic Psychology, Stephen has taught and lectured about hypnosis and NLP. As he explains it, only 2 things are needed: imagination and communication. Whatever your goal, if you can imagine it, you absolutely can do it. Whatever your dream, if Stephen and you can communicate, he can help you reach it. Please welcome our Table Topics Master, Mr. Stephen Morgan.
Here is a Toastmaster, but we have a couple, I believe, that aren't. This section of the meeting is where you get to practice your extemporaneous speaking skills. And if you didn't know what that word means, I'm talking about impromptu speaking. And if you didn't know what that word means, I'm going to say something, point at someone, they have to talk about it. And you don't know what's coming. You have to think on your feet, and the whole point is to practice. You don't have to do well, you just have to survive. And at some point, you're going to encounter the need to have this skill in your everyday life, which is why we like to do it here. Since our theme about our dreams, and you gave us a nice big list of ideas to go along with it. Hope you had fun reading it. I'm not using it. We all have the fun experience of dreaming while we're asleep. And some of those dreams can become nightmares. And yet, some of those dreams also turn out to be rather strange and weird, and some of them you may find out seem to be occurring in real life. Or we have our daydreams, our fantasies, the various ideas that we have of the way things should be, not the way they are. Now you'll have a few ideas of what to work with. When did you have one of your dreams encounter a reality check? Sarah.
One of my dreams of reality check. The last time I thought about dreams in the sense of going to sleep and waking up with a bad dream or a good dream was actually last night. It wasn't mine. When you have little kids, what happens? Mommy, 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 I had a dream. So last night, actually my oldest, who's 9 and is very good about staying in his room, much unlike the youngest, who frequently is in my bed. So when Dominic comes in, he says, I had an awful dream. There was some superpowers with a gun and you were shrunken and you were so small. I thought, I am small. I've never been big. I don't know what else happened, but he was terrified.
I couldn't think of my own dreams. I was really thinking about my own sleep, because at 4:30 a.m. is not an ideal time to come wake up your mother. And he's really good, and he's at that age where he's like, oh, I shouldn't go into bed, because that's not really what, you know, grown-up boys do. So I lay there. I knew he had gone nowhere, and I could see the shadow, and he was waiting for that invite. How much of us, how many times we wait for that invitation for one of us to share our dreams with someone that we love. And at that moment, I knew all he wanted was my love and to say, would you like to come lay down? So he did that. My sleep was ruined. And I got up half an hour later to go read my book. But that's the dream that occurred most recently. Thank you, Mr. Table Topics Master.
You know you've been doing something too long when you find yourself dreaming about it. So what exactly have you found yourself dreaming about for Toastmasters, Michelle?
Are you going to think I'm a bad person if I don't dream about Toastmasters?
Yeah, that is.
But I will tell you about a reoccurring dream, which I think is absolutely hilarious. Many of you know I own a website design business, and I've owned my business now for 15 years. This is my second career. My first career was a paralegal. I did that for 8.5 years, which was 19 years ago, and then minus 8.5 years before then. So for 19 years, I have not been working in the legal field. However, often enough, which surprises me, I dream about working in a legal office with an attorney and all the catty women that I used to work with. What a nightmare! Maybe I should just dream about Toastmasters.
A goal without a plan is merely a dream. What does your goal have for a plan, Pardeep? A goal without a plan is merely a dream. What is the plan for your goal?
I tend to be, I'm 35 now, and I really believe that the outlook we have in our life really dictates who we become. A wonderful father, a great employee, or wonderful health. So I have a dream to be a wonderful father, a wonderful husband, and maybe in the best shape of my life as I grow older. You may have all seen people who are 60, but they look or behave like 20. And vice versa. So I hope that this age limitation in my mind won't be a limitation for me, and I will be able to accomplish my goals. Thank you.
Ever experienced that sensation of, you know, you dream the situation and you see it happening right before you, that sense of deja vu? When does that happen to you, Bill?
Thank you, Mr. Table Topics Master, fellow Toastmasters, other guests. Deja vu happens all over again more than once. It seems that every time I dream, it's deja vu. I go back and I keep thinking, I'm a married man. Deja vu all over again, I am. I keep thinking that I have children. Oh, I do. I keep thinking that I have grandchildren. I can keep going. I keep thinking I have great-grandchildren. My other deja vu dream, as I go to the gym daily, I am going to look like Arnold Schwarzenegger. I know that I'm going to have that body because I can dream. Mr. Tabletop.
Dreams are made and used and wasted. And how does that, or what does that bring to mind for you, Ted?
I have a poor memory when it comes to dreams. However, if I do wake up sufficiently during that REM period, I come awake with these brilliant ideas, the solution to the world's problems. And of course, I don't bother to write them down. By morning, they're gone. Being able to capitalize on your ability to dream would be a wonderful asset. If we go to bed thinking about a problem, good chance are you're going to dream about it. And there's an even better chance that you're going to come up with a solution. So before this fantasy disappears, have a notepad or a pen by your bed so you can really capitalize on it. It's a whole side of life that could be extremely productive if we learn how to capitalize on it. Mr. Tabletop.
Thank you, Ted. That particular line is a line out of I Dreamed a Dream from Les Mis, so I can toss out the plug for my son's show. That River Players will be performing it at Lake Mary High March 10th, 11th, 12th. He has the role of Marius, and he loves singing, so if you have the time, come out and see it. How much more do you have?
One more.
Well then, since I was talking about lyrics, there's a song that's called Where Dreams Go to Die. And this is interesting, because the lyrics included in there saying, "Baby, where your dreams go to die, and I regret the day your lovely carcass caught my eye." So who does that remind you of? Messy.
I had a fancy that you would ask me that question. I would say that it reminds me of my husband. I've been with him 45 years, which is a very long time. We're coming up on our 45th anniversary. It's going to be in July. We're planning to go on a cruise out of Miami, and I could get to spend a whole week, just have a fantasy week with my husband. He works all the time. I'm retired now, so he's a truck driver. He leaves on Monday morning, comes by late Friday night, so I spend my whole week without seeing him. So I think of those lyrics when I think about my husband, how much I love him, and how much I would love to share my time with him. I tried to get him to retire when I did, and he didn't. He felt like he can't do anything besides work. And every time I ask him, "Well, when are you going to stop working so you can spend time with me?" The huh? I don't even know what I say, but he pretending. That's what those lyrics remind me of. So thank you for that question.
My fantasy was everyone had so much to say, they all went over time. At a time, what did they do?
Everybody was on that.
you don't have to.
No,
we have at least 1 minute.
Okay, so almost definitely will have to have a party to see what's trying to speak about. So, with times Sarah was jail, I did ask you not to bug me.
Oh, that's right.
Sarah was 1 minute and 20 seconds, Michelle 1 minute 6, Pradeep 42 seconds, Bill 1 minute exactly, Ted 1 minute 80 seconds, and Bessie 1 minute and 27 seconds.
So cast your vote for best table topics from Sarah, Bill, Bessie, Michelle, or Ted, and Mr. Toastmaster.
Thank you, Stephen. Before I relinquish control of the lectern, one of my dreams was to actually get that right, not call it a podium. I want to share with you the opportunity to look at question number 20. This is one you can literally start working on this very second. There's a lot of very important questions on this sheet. Some are fun, some are not so fun, but that is, what qualities do you want others to remember you for? If you don't have good answers for that one, I'll leave it to you to judge what good answers are. Questions 1 through 19 simply won't matter. You will still feel like everything is missing. Tonight, the fantasy of our illustrious president and tonight's general evaluator are of the days on the beach after April 18th, celebrating the end of tax season. It is going to be a long 2.5 months. Please welcome our general evaluator, Jay Majors, and give her some of your sympathy.
As well as table topics, don't you all agree?
Yes.
It's been a fabulous evening, and I love having all of you guests here tonight. In the interest of time, I want to jump right into our first evaluator. Julian Cotto has been a member of the Central Florida Facilitators since 2011. As a facilitator, he has earned the Advanced Communicator Bronze Award, and he is a skip away from earning the Advanced Communicator Silver Award. Evaluating is his most challenging skill and one which he continues to work on to become better at offering constructive feedback in a positive manner. Each evaluation provides another step in honing his evaluation skills and hopefully providing some meaningful insight to the speaker. Please help me welcome soon-to-be Advanced Communicator Silver, Julian Cotto, evaluating speaker. Thank you.
May, you showed us incredible courage tonight, and it just goes to show that the only thing we need to fulfill any one of our dreams is to just do it. At 99 years old, without being able to hear, without being able to see, and without being able to walk, you got up here and showed a lot of people that you have more courage than a lot of the youngins that don't have the guts to do what you did. And it was an awesome speech, looking backwards and looking forwards. And I love the unique format that you guys came up with. And I know that you did it because you love Tony and this was her present. And you know, life has its funny quirks, because we also call Tony our little monster. Your speech was well organized. You had an opening from the beginning. We all knew what the speech was about and how you were going to develop it. And Tony was right there helping develop the speech. And I understand it was a great format for you. I think that was very unique and very creative. And we certainly learned a lot about you. And the speech was the goal was how to say it. And May said what she needed to say. She interjected some humor. And I now know that when I'm 99 years old, if I ever get to that stage, I better get comfortable with peeing. Because I might spend a lot of time doing that, more so than now. And Paul Newman, how can you not fall in love with Paul Newman? Even I think he's a beautiful man. So definitely we learned a lot about you. You said everything in very succinct ways, and I believe you did a great job in fulfilling the goals of your speech, and I hope you'll come back and do it some more. Madam.
Okay, let's move to our next evaluator. Is proud to have finished the requirements for advanced silver speaker, just as proud as he is in having the opportunity to evaluate.
No, you got it wrong.
Kristen. Oh, you. Okay. While evaluating isn't part of her fantasies, our next evaluator is more than happy and excited to give an evaluation on Renee Taylor's first speech. Please welcome Kristen Williams.
Tackling her icebreakers. So, much like the title states, the purpose of Renee's speech was to, in fact, break the ice, put herself out there, start getting comfortable with the idea of speaking in front of an audience, and more importantly, share more about herself and her background to help us get to know her a little better. So, she did just that. First of all, absolutely loved your confidence. I would have never guessed that that was your first speech because you came in guns blazing. Forget the lectern, forget the note cards, insert a clean, informative, and humorous icebreaker speech because that was what you did. You took us on a chronological tour of your life. So starting from being a baby in the Bahamas to a young pup in New York, over to San Francisco, where you found your niche in adult pleasure parties. And then you made your way over to Georgia, a small town in Georgia, a little hop up to Atlanta, quick trip back down to the Bahamas, a detour over to New York again, and now you found your home for yourself in Florida. So first in Jacksonville, now in Orlando. Your speech was great. You had poise, great energy. I'm happy you were also able to expand your education into a career that you really love. I know we've talked about that before too, so I like being able to see it all come together. And all while trying to better yourself along the way with Toastmasters. So from an improvement perspective, I can't really touch on anything in particular. I thought it was a great job for an icebreaker, far better than what I'm still impressed that you didn't use a lectern because I still have separation anxiety. It was well prepared, well rehearsed, and very much excited to see your progression throughout Toastmasters and hear more speeches from you. So, job well done.
Thank you. Thank you.
Now, let's start this one over again. Our next evaluator is proud to have finished the requirements for Advanced Communicator Silver. just as proud as he is in having the opportunity to evaluate a speaker. It is a privilege to be able to help a fellow Toastmaster achieve their speaking goals. Please help me welcome Charlie Bombalier, evaluating the speech of Richard Sapp.
Madam General Evaluator, fellow Toastmasters, and welcome guests, and of course, Mr. Richard Sapp. Richard, without question, this was not a fantasy speech. The objective of your speech tonight was to get comfortable with visuals. No question that was accomplished. The second one was that you were to select visual aids that are appropriate for the message and the audience. Well done, Richard. Third, you were to use two or more visual aids correctly with ease and confidence. Again, mission accomplished. As per your speech, Richard, your introduction was awesome. I liked it because you told us the basic part of selling real estate. Of course, I was a little busy per your request to take pictures, so I missed the first few lines that you gave us. But I believe it was something, one of those were locations, pricing, and marketing. Then you showed us the credentials. All your credentials were great. And you even went as far as to show us your whole team's credentials. That was awesome because it takes a team like you have now to be able to be successful in the real estate business. You gave us an education on the very core of what it takes to do a listening presentation. Here's a little bit of food for thought for your next speech. This was a very informative speech. When you give informative speech, sometimes some people get a little bored. And I'm being serious. You have to get excitement about it. In other words, like something like, you gave us a little bit too much detail in the middle, but you could have given us this kind of presentation. Tell us how many homes you sell a week, a month, and this is how many we sell during the year. We're an awesome team. That gets us excited to even listen more. Other than that, you're always professionally dressed. You have a great presence up here on stage. And your voice was crystal clear. Very easy to hear you from the back. A great speech, and I hope to hear you speak again soon. Adam Gilman.
From you. However, I'd just like to note that Bill, you had a like and or so. Where's Bill? There he is. Miss May, actually Tony, she had, what was it, two ahs. No big deal. Michelle had one like and or so. Ted Allman, none this evening. Bessie, two ahs and ums, one double clutch, and one like and or so. And the big fantasy winner, the jackpot, Renee Taylor, our icebreaker, who is not fine because it is her icebreaker. You don't have to pay your dollar this evening. But I would like to point out that your main word that was misplaced often was the word so. However, those who do owe, Tony, 20 cents, two infractions. Emma, four infractions for 40 cents. Richard Sapp, dollar. Sarah Hunt, 20 cents. Pardeep, I caught nothing. Julian Cotto had one you know, one so. Charlie, you had a like and or so, a double clutch, and a click. Where's Charlie?
Right here.
Back there. A click. 30 cents to you. Miss Madam Jack, you've had the waiter.
Grammarian's report, please.
It was a fantasy meeting for word usage today. I was writing a lot for all the great word usage I heard, and of course the word of the day. Johnny used it twice. I heard Susan, Tony, Renee, Richard, Emma, Stephen used it twice. Ted, Bessie used it twice. Jay, Kristen, Charlie, and Gail. Did I miss anyone who used it? If you didn't use it,
is there a fine?
For
not using it? Yes, 25
cents to the soccer ball if you had a chance to use it today. Guests are exempt, of course. For colorful phrases, I had Charlie, a measure of borrowed time. Reckless hate, mission accomplished, and food for thought. Jay, you used jam-packed, which the meeting definitely was today. John, all of your phrases on your questionnaire. But pretty sad shape, you started right off. Re-engaged with their life. Dream starter questions, dream storm, subpar friendship, accountability partner, and relinquish control. May, blue eyes. That was great. Took my little monster out, of course. What else can't I do? She asked you. And of course, I peed. Renee, sparking the movement. The island wasn't big enough for both of them. Mecca for black people, wow. And sister girlfriends, I like that term. I don't know if I could use brother boyfriends or not. That might be a little weird, but maybe I have them. The one thing I caught from you in a way of grammar usage is you said the .com bubble had bust. I think you meant burst or had busted, either way. But that was the only thing for you that I caught in the way that I used. It's really good, beautiful speaking today. Richard, condensed and expedited, prime derivative, more autonomy, and post and coast. I like that a lot. Stephen, imagination and communication, extemporaneous, sense of deja vu, and tossed out the plug, which he did very well today, and I am very interested in seeing Les Mis, one of my favorite shows. Julian, honing evaluation skills. That was in your introduction, but a really good phrase. The youngins, interjected humor, get comfortable with peeing, and succinct. Kristen, give it up for Renee. Guns blazing, chronological tour, and separation anxiety, which I think we've all had with this lovely little barrier that we can stand behind, right? Tony,
meet your Prince Charming, driving Miss Maisie. Wow, that was great. Sarah, shrunken. I don't want to be shrunken in my dreams or in reality. I completely understand. Michelle, catty women. I'm so sorry you had to deal with your catty women. Bill, deja vu happens all over again more than once. Yogi Berra would be proud of you. And Ted, wake up sufficiently during that REM period and capitalize on it. That was a full Grammarian's report. Thank you very much.
Always a good thing to see our guests, and especially May. Thank you for coming to join us tonight. This was a real treat that I hope we all agree, I know we all agree, that it was to have someone like you come join us. Our meeting, as I said earlier, was jam-packed. That's the first thing that hit me when I walked in the door, Jonathan. Thank you. We have actually done very well moving along. We're hitting right up on our time. We've got a few more minutes, so we're not going to go over that far. I think that's a good thing. A testament to how everybody jumped in and moved along. I want to thank Renee for getting up and doing that icebreaker. It's one of my goals as the president of this club to see our newer members get up and do their icebreakers. It's the first place where our members begin to take ownership of their membership in the club. If they can't get to the icebreaker, then they can't get to the speeches that follow. For me, that's one of the biggest and best educational parts of being a new Toastmaster, that first speech, whatever it takes to do it, to get up and do it. So that to me was my big takeaway, and it will be every time I see someone doing their icebreaker. Now, let us move along to some awards.
Guests?
Oh, okay. Guests comment, can we keep them short? Please. Let's just start at the front of the room and make our way back.
You want me to make my announcement now then, or do you want to
wait yes.
until the end?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
Then, quick announcement. This is one of the two reasons I came here tonight was to announce that ACE, the Advanced Toastmasters Club in Division D, which is the division that we are all located in, we meet first and third Monday nights at the Metro Church in Winter Springs, right at the corner of where Alafaya hits the 417, the Greenway. Out there, first and third, Monday nights at 7 p.m. I bring it up because it's contest season. Anyone planning on competing from this club, or are you going to sit it out this year?
Yeah.
Huh. You think you're going to compete? All right. Well, then why don't you try and step up your game a little bit and get a little coaching? Where would you get coaching? At ACE. Next Monday night, this very one coming up, January 30th, we are doing a table topics meeting. When I say a table topics meeting, we do table topics at every meeting. What's so special? We're going to evaluate the table topics at that meeting. Come, if you're planning on competing or even thinking about competing, come Monday night to our meeting. We'll ask you a table topics question. You'll get to answer the question, and then we're going to go around the room and give you feedback on what we really liked about your answer and where you might be able to improve. You don't get evaluated on your table topics very often, and you certainly don't always get a chance from people who are all competent communicators or above, which is what ACE Advanced Toastmasters is about. The week after that, a week from Monday, we are doing a very focused international speech session where you'll be able to give your international speech, get an evaluation, a round robin evaluation where we'll go around the room and help make your speech better, and then time allowing, which I know we're up against it now, you'll get a chance to give your speech again after receiving your feedback, something you almost never get to do at a club, and certainly very valuable when you're about to do a contest speech. Come give that speech, get the feedback, and then apply it immediately. How often do we go home, forget the speech, much less the feedback? But if you're going to do it at the contest, always good to come, get the feedback, and then do it again immediately, because it'll stick. That feedback will really take hold. So next Monday night, table topics meeting. The week after that, international speech focus. If you just want to come and see what it's all about, we'd love to have you as guests. But if you're thinking about competing this year, come to ACE. I have flyers. I'm going to bring them around the room over, finishing up other business.
Maybe email it out to get it out.
I am happy to email it to all of you as well.
Pass it along.
Email the flyer.
Yes, let me.
Yeah, and then we can get it out.
If it's okay, I'll hand it out too.
To the area.
That'd be great.
Who else would like to make have any comments? For our meeting.
I like you.
You like me? Okay, very well then.
Thank you, my great friend.
If there are no other comments, are there any other announcements that need to be made before I do awards? Any other announcements that can't go on the website or be emailed out? Yes.
Hey, it was 30 seconds. Review the schedule. There's two of them that are circulating that we can announce next week.
And he's got one back there. Okay. Doing
okay. Schedule. Please check your meetup and sign up to meetup. Click on it, save your comment, invite your friends and neighbor to click on it. I sent all of you an invite. I can't make it any easier than show up to your house and actually make you hit that keyboard. Thank you.
All right, you're welcome.
I sent an invite to the meeting.
I'd like to invite anybody interested in parliamentary procedure. I'm doing a workshop February 28th, Saturday morning from about 9 to 12. And we are going to continue that in practice sessions on a monthly basis thereafter. Because you don't learn anything by just listening to a lecture. But the practice is key. We will also be preparing anybody who's interested in the National Association of Parliamentarians. There's an entrance exam that you take, and you'll be fully prepared to take that if you're interested in pursuing it. Thank you.
Is that it? Mm-hmm. Okay, awards, finally. The first award is our club award, the Tim Chastain Award, and it's specific to our club. The person who gets this club, this award, is somebody who has gone above and beyond and done a lot to help facilitate the meeting and move it forward. Tonight, that award is going to Tony Gibbles for helping with the projector and for bringing May to us and guiding May along tonight. Next, the most improved award, and I wholeheartedly agree, Renee Taylor. Goes to Renee Taylor. adjourn.
Schedule? Here, Gail. Okay.
Thank you. Next week, Toastmaster. Who? We do have two speakers. Hardeep with his icebreaker. And Julian Cope, I believe this will be the start of a new communication level?
No, the end of my advanced, my humor speech advanced learning.
Okay. Table topics. Our own Kristen Williams, general evaluator. Because I had two schedules going around, we have a duel, so one of you may have to do Toastmaster. Susan Morgan, Charlie Bonlier, who wants to be Toastmaster? Going once.
I'll do it.
All right. And think of a thing if you can, that we can announce before we disappear here. Evaluators, we have three. Richard Sapp, Stephen Morgan, Jay Majors. Supervisor of Elections, Renee Taylor. Awe Counter, Emma Hancock. Grammarian, Tony Giddles. And our timer, we need one. Who can be a timer next week? All right. We will find one. I will not.
I'll be a timer.
You'll
am I signed up for anything?
You're speaking. Sarah says.
Sarah, all right. Good going. I will not be here next week. Who can step up, take one of these copies to circulate next week for sign up?
I don't know if easy speaking is best for me. Tell me how to find it.
I'll give you a copy. Okay, Tony, thank you very much.
Thank you.
All right, and without... without further ado, our meeting is adjourned.